Our next speaker is Abbot Damascene. He is the Abbot of St. Herman of Alaska Monastery. He is a contributor to the Unbroken Circle and was the keynote speaker at the 26th Ancient Christianity and African American Conference. He has written several articles and books, including Father Seraphim Rose, His Life and Work. The title of his talk is Orthodox Patristic Themes in Golden Age African American Gospel Music. Please welcome Abbot Damascene.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I'm Abbot Damascene of the St. Herman of Alaska Monastery in California, and I am giving a talk now on ancient Orthodox teaching in African American gospel music of the Golden Age. When I say the Golden Age, I'm speaking of the gospel music that began in about 1945. Some say this Golden Age ended in the 1960, but there were still great performers from that generation, still performing in the 70s and even 80s, and a few even lasted were performing into the 90s. In this talk, I'll be comparing specific quotes from Holy Fathers of the Orthodox Church with the lyrics of gospel songs, and I'll also be playing some gospel songs. Before I make this comparison, I'd like to give some historical background. The Orthodox Church is the same church that was founded by our Lord Jesus Christ in Jerusalem. Now, during the first three centuries of Christianity, not only in Jerusalem, but all over the Roman Empire, Christianity was persecuted. Christians, in many cases, had to live in hiding. In Rome, they literally lived under the ground in the catacombs. They knew that they could be captured at any time, tortured, killed for their faith. And so during those first centuries, Christianity was anything but a comfortable faith. In the early church, people understood that in these sufferings, in these persecutions, the church thrived spiritually. There's even a saying from these early centuries that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. But then, in 313 AD, Emperor Constantine, who was the emperor of the Eastern Roman Empire, first issued an edict of toleration of the Christian faith, and then later made Christianity the state religion. At that time, the makeup of the Christian congregations changed dramatically, as you might imagine. Now, the church was filled with not only these fervent Christians that I've just described, but also with people who became Christians because that's what the surrounding society did. So their faith may be more or less strong. And so there was awakened in the people of God a desire to keep the flame alive that had been nurtured during those three centuries of the catacombs. And so these people went off into the deserts, and they took upon themselves voluntary hardship in place of the involuntary hardship and persecution that they underwent in the first three centuries. And so the desert became a city, as they say, filled with monks and nuns, those striving for union with God. And in the midst of that hardship and ascetic labor that they took upon themselves, they found that joy, that deep abiding faith and awareness of the reality of Christ, which the early Christians knew. Let's fast forward to the 17th century, and we're going to look now at the African-American experience. When the African people first were brought to America and enslaved, they didn't, of course, know English, but in addition, they often didn't even know the language of their fellow Africans, because there's many different languages. And so, how could they express their grief, their pain, after everything they have gone through, everything they were going through? They would gather together and call out to God in whatever way they knew. But since they didn't have a common language, at least in the beginning, they would moan their songs, their melodies. And this moaning would be a release. It would be a catharsis for the people who were suffering under that yoke of slavery. But then, as time went on, of course, they learned the language. Although the masters, in many cases, forbade their slaves to learn to read, some of them did. Some of them taught the people, and so they went deep into the Christian faith. They not only believed it, they clung to it for dear life. That was their solace. That was the miraculous, otherworldly power that made their suffering not only bearable, but brought them joy. They saw fulfilled in themselves the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Beatitudes, where he says, "And he lifted up his eyes and his disciples and said, Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for ye shall be filled. Blessed are ye that weep now, for ye shall laugh. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you, and when they shall separate you from their company, and shall reproach you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice ye in that day, and leap for joy, for behold, your reward is great in heaven. For in like manner did their fathers unto the prophets." So the African-American slaves living here, they would read words like these, and they would see, understand that they were created in the image of God. They weren't created to be slaves. They knew, as we know from the testimonies that came out after the emancipation, that they knew that not only were they not meant to be slaves, but that they would be delivered from slavery. They read not only the New Testament, but they also read the Old Testament. They identified with the Jewish people who themselves were under slavery. They saw how the Lord delivered them. They had the same hope for themselves. But most of all, their hope was in heaven. We can see that, we can hear that by listening to the songs, because so many of them speak of that longing for heaven, the longing to be with Jesus Christ, the longing to experience his love, and to love him forever. After the emancipation, as we all know, the whites in the South still tried to hold on to whatever power they could, and that was the era of Jim Crow and segregation, where the black people in America still had to suffer in some form these same indignities which our Lord just spoke of in these Beatitudes. And in that suffering, in that hardship, that affliction they had to live with, they continued to find solace and joy in the Christian faith, in their deep, abiding experience of Jesus Christ. So, that is why there is a connection between the writings of the Holy Fathers of the Orthodox Church in ancient times, from early centuries of Christianity, where they speak about suffering and about drawing closer to God in suffering. The link between that and our African-American experience here in this country. So far, I've spoken about the African-American experience in general. Now I would like to speak about the music, the songs they produced. The songs that were composed by African-Americans under slavery came to be known as the spirituals. These represent what some notable musicologists and folklorists have regarded as the greatest artistic contribution of America, period. After the emancipation, the African Americans continued singing their spirituals, both among themselves in their worship services, and also they would perform them throughout the world to various audiences who were very deeply moved by them. Of course, new songs would be written during that time, which would be sung in the churches as well. There were also street preachers who performed music. Great ones like Washington Phillips, Blind Willie Johnson, and the list goes on. And then in the 1940s, the music known as gospel music was born. This was just an outgrowth of their earlier music. They did bring in other musical styles of African Americans from secular music, but then the gospel music, the form of the music, later influenced the secular. The content was purely Christian, and in fact, the people of that time had a very keen awareness of the difference between gospel music, which is music for God and about God, and secular music, which is about all kinds of secular concerns and secular, even secular sins and passions. In the early years after gospel music was introduced in the churches, some people were skeptical. They thought it sounded too worldly. But this kind of music became quite popular in the churches. And also, the gospel performers would travel what they called the gospel highway, giving concerts along the way and lifting the spirits of the people. Now, I myself was a purist like those people in the early years of gospel. At the beginning, I only listened to the spirituals. The gospel music sounded too worldly to me. However, in the last several years, I broadened my scope of interest, and I listened to these songs. And I was just blown away. Because like the spirituals, they express a deep experience of Jesus Christ, the reality of Jesus Christ. So now that I've given some background, we will now look first at the Holy Fathers and their writings on these subjects, and then we'll listen to the music. Here in this talk, I'm going to focus on the themes of redemptive suffering, which I've described, which is connected with another theme, and that is that Christians are not at home in this world. And yet another linked theme is the fruits of the Spirit, which Christians experience when they go through this redemptive suffering in devotion to God. I'll begin by quoting from St. Thalassius of Lybia, a 7th century father whose writings are found in the Philokalia, Volume 2. He says, "Fearful afflictions await the hard of heart, for without great sufferings they cannot become pliable and responsive." So, what he's saying is people have hard hearts. It's not good for us to have hard hearts. We make ourselves miserable and those around us miserable. And we will not get into heaven with a hard heart. So therefore, we have to make our hearts soft and pliable. Actually, we cannot do this. It's only with God's help that we can do this. And we, cooperate with God. In Orthodox Church, we call it synergy. Cooperate with God in softening our hard hearts. But what St. Thalassius says here is that if a person does not repent, is still hard in heart,
and also does not take on voluntary sufferings, God's going to give that person sufferings in order to make the heart soft. But there's good news, because if God gives us sufferings in order to soften our hard hearts, that means that God knows that we have hope, that we can change, we can use that experience of affliction to come closer to Him. Whereas those who experience no afflictions, have no difficulties, should be more concerned, because that means that God very likely thinks that that person is so hard of heart that if God gave that person afflictions, the person would be even more against God and his fellow man. Now I'm going to quote from St. Isaac the Syrian. As St. Peter wrote in his letter, "When you suffer for righteousness' sake, blessed are you, for you will become sharers in the sufferings of Christ. Therefore, when you are at ease and enjoyment, do not rejoice. And when tribulations come upon you, do not be sullen or consider this as something alien to the way of God. For this path of God has been trodden from all the ages and through all generations by means of the cross and death. Where do you get the idea that the afflictions on the path do not belong on the path? Do you not wish to follow in the footsteps of the saints? Do you want to travel by some special path of your own? One that does not involve suffering? The path to God is a daily cross. No one has ascended to God by way of ease. We know where the easy way leads." That was written by St. Isaac the Syrian in the 7th century. Of course, St. Isaac is drawing from the teaching of our Lord Jesus Christ. "If anyone will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever will save his life will lose it, and whoever will lose his life for my sake will find it." His words also reflect the teaching of Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. "I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong." In other words, in suffering, we realize our infirmity, our dependence on God. In fact, that's why God allowed suffering in the world in the first place, which only came into the world after the fall of Adam and Eve. Suffering makes us realize that we're not God, that we need God, and we depend on Him for our life. And so in the midst of that suffering, when we realize that we're really not so great after all, and that there is a God above us, then that's when God comes and touches the soul. And through this synergy, this process of man cooperating with God, our souls are gradually purified. We are made more and more into the likeness of God, the likeness of Jesus Christ. And this is our preparation to dwell with Him forever in the kingdom of light, in the kingdom of love. Now I'll read from the Ladder of Divine Ascent by St. John Climacus, a 6th century father who lived near Mount Sinai in Egypt. This is from Step 7 of the Ladder on Joy Making Mourning. "Mourning, according to God, is sadness of soul and the disposition of a sorrowing heart, which ever madly seeks that for which it thirsts, and when it fails in its quest, it painfully pursues it and follows in its wake, grievously lamenting. Or thus, mourning is a golden spur in a soul which is stripped of all attachment and of all ties, fixed with holy sorrow to watch over the heart." Now here, St. John is speaking of a very profound repentance. In Greek, the word for repentance is metanoia, which means literally to change the mind. Our mind is changed from the mind of this world, the mind of our sinful passions, and in a process of being changed into the mind of Christ. Another passage from the same chapter says, "The groanings and sorrows cry to the Lord. Tears shed from fear for intercede for us." In other words, fear of punishment by God, those can help us. "But tears of all holy love show us that our prayer has been accepted." In other words, God can bring compunction to a soul. And this is that softening of the hard heart, which we spoke of earlier. So if we're shedding tears of all holy love towards Christ, then that is a blessing in itself. But we should not grow proud if it ever happens, or when it happens, because the moment we get proud, then the blessings disappear. Now I'll speak about this related theme. That is, namely, how we as Christians are not at home in this world. We have the words of Christ on this topic. "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you." So this is what our Lord Jesus Christ foretold. And we've seen throughout the centuries how these words have proven true, that the Christian faith is at odds with the mind of the world and the lovers of this world. Here's a quote from St. Macarius the Great, was writing in the 5th century. He says, "Christians have their own world, their own way of life, and mentality and word and activity. Quite different is the way of life and mentality and word and activity of the people of this world. One thing is Christians, and another the lovers of the world. Between the one and the other is a great separation." So that's the arduous path of the Christian leads to this state of dispassion. But when I speak of the arduous path, we have to remember the words of the Lord, which he has also fulfilled, that when we take upon ourselves the yoke of Christ, we find that the yoke is easy and the burden is light, because he is with us in our suffering, caring for us, uplifting us, and healing our souls, burning off the dross of sin, and leaving the precious gold of virtue. And that leads to another common theme between the experience of the Holy Fathers of the early centuries and the African Americans, and that is the subject of the transformation of the soul and the fruits of this transformation. Above all, the fruits of the transformation are seen in love for others, forgiveness of others, as well, of course, as our love for God, which should be above all. These are the commandments of our Lord Jesus Christ himself. St. John the Apostle speaks about perfect love, how Christians should strive for perfect love. St. Maximus the Confessor wrote 200 short texts on love, which is found in the second volume of the Philokalia. And he tells us what this perfect love is. Quote, "You have not yet acquired perfect love if your regard for people is still swayed by their characters. For example, if for some particular reason you love one person and hate another, or for the same reason, you sometimes love and sometimes hate the same person. Perfect love does not split up the single human nature common to all, according to the diverse characteristics of individuals. But fixing attention always on this single nature, it loves all people equally. Now that, of course, is a tall order. There's no way that human beings, by their own powers, could ever fulfill this commandment. It's only by the grace of God. It's only by the redemptive power of our Lord Jesus Christ, his life, his death, his resurrection, the life that he infuses in Christians, that we, the followers of Jesus Christ, are able to even dream about attaining such love. When we love in this manner, we are seeing our own sins, our own failings, realizing that we have in common with the rest of humanity this broken, fallen human nature, which at the same time has something good within it. And so if we know ourselves in this way, then we can know others in the same way, not hating those who are doing something bad, but because we know that there's something good in them, and not overly valuing people that seem to be good, because we know that even the greatest saints have some sins left. I'd like now to read a very brief but beautiful passage from an ex-slave. This was recorded among the many testimonies given by former slaves after emancipation. She speaks about the spiritual transformation that occurred in her when she became a Christian. She writes, "I ran to an elm tree and tried to put my arms around it. Never had I felt such a love before. I just looked like I loved everything and everybody. The eyes of my mind were opened, and I saw things as I never did before." Now, this is what we call a very clear visitation of God's grace. As I said, we cannot love everybody except when God gives us the grace to do so. This is what St. Paul calls the renewing of the mind, a level of spiritual understanding in which everything appears differently because one is now a new creature, a new person in Christ. So these are these themes. I've read the quotes from the Holy Fathers, and now we come to the songs of the Golden Age Gospel, which reflect these teachings.
The first song we'll hear is from this album by Dorothy Love Coates and her singers, including her sister Lillian. Dorothy Love Coates is my favorite of all the gospel singers of the Golden Age because she not only sang the songs, she wrote the songs, and most importantly, she lived the life she sang about, a life of faithfulness, virtue, and self-sacrifice. The song I'll play is called The Old School. It's actually a suite of three songs interspersed with Dorothy's narration about growing up in the Black Church. Both the songs and the commentary touch on the theme of not being at home in this world, which, as we've seen, has been a mark of genuine Christians throughout the centuries.
Now let's take a listen.
Children, I'm from the old school, namely the Black Church, where gospel music originated many years ago, and I was first introduced to the gospel sound. The freedom and privileges we presently enjoy was not available to us back then. And being from a race who have suffered many years from financial depression, the old Black minister couldn't afford an education. And the pianist who played the old upright piano in the corner wasn't musically educated, but the preaching, praying, and singing that projected itself into the hearts and minds of my people kept hope alive in them. The Black church was the school, and this was the sound.
Thank you.
say it like this. They believed in prayer, God, and they felt that when folks stopped praying, the world was in a bad condition.
I can't hear nobody pray. Lord, you know, I can't hear nobody pray, and I can't.
See, they knew all about living in an unfriendly world.
I can't.
They had many trials and tribulations. Before they could afford an instrument, even the old upright piano that sat in the corner, they used to sing without music. In this modern day and age, we call it a cappella, but they call it singing out of the soul. They used to keep the beat with the patting of the feet. They used to keep time by clapping their hands. They used to keep the rhythm with a bodily rock as they swayed to and fro. And this is what the sound was like. I'm just rolling. And it relates to my people. It's a way of communicating with God without doing it verbally. And the old folk used to say, when you mourn, Satan can't understand what you're talking about. And they understood mourning because they were people of sorrow, well acquainted with grief. They knew what it meant to want and not have, to need and not get, to feel misery and persecution and pain. And when you see them close their eyes and begin to rock and watch the tears roll down their faces, they would say it one more time. Lord, I'm just a and watch the son go to jail because they couldn't afford a lawyer. Maybe a father had gone out looking for a job and couldn't find one. They had hopes and dreams like everybody else for the welfare and the future of their children. But they say, I'm rolling through it all. From the old school.
Now the next track is from a relatively unknown gospel group, the Traveling Echoes. It's called I'm Looking for a Better Place to Live.
Lord, I'm looking for a better place to live. Lord, after I die, every day I'm looking for a better place to live. Oh, yes, I am.
keep looking for a better place to live. Oh, help me, Lord. I'm looking for a better place to live. After I die, every day I'm looking, Lord, for a better place to live. After I die, I'm at home. It don't seem like home down here in this old world anymore. Keep on looking for a better place to live. Oh, oh, ever since I've been living down here in this old world, this world of sin, I'm trying and tribulation every day. Yes, I do, Lord. Said there's something more I love, always to destroy my happiness. Keep on looking. I've got to find me. Help me, Lord. I've got to find.
The next song from the Gospel Golden Age that we'll hear is I Need the Lord to Guide Me by the Trumpets of Joy. This song is also about the narrow way that we have to travel, a way of afflictions. And he says in his desperation that I've got to have Jesus. I just can't make it by myself. He says, sometimes at night, I just have to walk the floor and cry. We've seen how these tears, which are shed in devotion to God, can bring the soul into closer union with Him.
I need the Lord to guide me every day. Children, as I travel, oh yes,
along this narrow way.
Although affliction oppress this old soul of mine, I'm
determined to reach my goal.
I got to have Jesus, just can't make it by myself. Well, sometimes at night, I just have to walk the floor and cry. Oh, yeah, oh, Lord, late in the midnight hour, I walk the floor and cry. Every time I feel this way, Lord, I pray. Every day of my life, I pray. Yes, I do.
I pray.
You know, I pray.
And that's the Lord.
Every hour of the day, through the weeks, through the months, through the years, come with me.
I got to have Jesus.
Now we'll hear a song entitled It's Jesus, Y'all by Troy Ramey and the Soul Searchers. This song is about the fruits of God, God's grace, which are given to the soul, which remains in devotion to Him throughout all manner of difficulties in life. He says, something inside of me keeps on bubbling over. It's Jesus, y'all. I know that it is. I got something inside of me keep on holding the reins. This is a very meaningful line, besides being a beautiful image, that God is holding the reins inside of us. In other words, keeping us from sinning, from giving in to our sinful passions. So this is the fruit. He has something, some joy bubbling inside. Someone holding the reins in his heart. He says, I cannot explain. Yes, of course, this is immaterial things. These are the mysteries of God. He says, if anybody asks me, it's Jesus, y'all. Then he says, make you love everybody. Where have we heard that before? Something inside of me. Make me cry when ain't nobody bothering me. Got it? That's what these tears are called, the tears of repentance. It could be tears over your life situation, but it could be tears of joy. It could be just a tears of being aware of God's presence.
Something inside of me keep on bubbling over. I got something inside of me. I'm bubbling over. If anybody asks me, I tell them, it's Jesus, y'all. Inside,
got it all inside,
that I cannot explain.
Won't let me
explain. If anybody asks me, it's Jesus. I know it is. I'm not worried about it. Jesus,
may we be in the spirit of these great people that we've just been talking about. May we enter into the spirit of humility, into the spirit of forgiveness, of love, suffering all things for Christ's sake, because we know that He is working all things for our good in order to purify us and make us more perfect, so that we will love everyone equally and share in the divine likeness. Amen.